Совсем укладываемся уже в регламент. Я попытаюсь сократить свои два доклада в более сжатые сроки. Итак, первое сообщение посвящено
experimental experience. You all know that childhood orthopedics, more than two-thirds of orthopedic diseases of children are caused to the wrong growth of by the wrong growth of bones, either too fast or too slow or just wrong, etc. On this slide, you can see the most bright examples of growth diseases: idiopathic scoliosis, the discovery of our symposium, the presentation of Professor Dudin, different lengths of lower extremities. That's the most common thing that every orthopedist knows about, and some congenital diseases, inborn diseases. Of course, these are extremities, but this is a good illustration. Let me remind you what is the special structure which is responsible for bone growth and which makes a difference between the skeleton of a child and of an adult. The growth plates were studied in many different ways, gestology, etc. What are the special features of these growth plates? That is the metabolism, that is the cartilage, and some gestologists compare it to the epithelium exchange process. It seems to be an inert system, I mean the cartilage, but this cannot be said about the growth plate. On average, in that plate, there are up to 8 new cell layers per day. That's what the American scientists have discovered. It's an average result, but anyway, 8 new cell layers per day. And one of the peculiarities of the cartilage of the growth plate is its maximum sensitivity to any interim or exterior factors. Two diseases are a good example of that. Every student knows about it. This is scurvy and rickets. I will not describe it in detail. And finally, radiosensitivity of the growth plate. I mentioned that these may be either exterior or interior factors, so a good example of influence of the exterior factor is the ray therapy. Yet in the year 1906, Jean Bergonnier and Louis Tribandot discovered a rule. Cells, any cells are more sensitive to radiation if they multiply quickly and if they are not very differentiated. This rule still works. The less differentiated, the faster they grow, the more sensitive they are to any exterior factor. Experimental study of the year 47 proves that the X-ray with from 600 to 1,000 rentgen slows down the bone growth, and the same study on rats was conducted. In the year 59, the irradiation of epiphyses slows down and disrupts the development, and bones are disrupted. These are the extracts from Volkov thesis. So we have that growth plate, the anatomical structure. We have a wide range of orthopedic diseases that, to this or that extent, involve the growth plates. And how can we influence the functional activity of the growth plates? Of course, ray therapy we shall not conduct for that. Pharmacotherapy, yes, it may influence the functional activity of the growth plates, but it will always be a systemic activity, and it has a lot of side effects, pharmacotherapy. So if we want to have a local selective impact, this method is possible, but it's not always acceptable, though in certain endocrinology diseases it's acceptable. And finally, there's the magnetic field. It's widely used in medicine. In the year 97-98, we've decided this is the best method. Why magnetic field? Because magnetic field may penetrate deep into the live tissues of the body. Magnetic field doesn't make you feel bad, no pain, no other unpleasant feelings. And magnetic biology since the year of 1970s has accumulated a lot of experience. There's plenty of fundamental works. This is a table that illustrates the effects that may be obtained by using of magnetic fields. Let me list some of them. The slowdown of caviar, fish caviar, development, fibroblasts of the rabbit, both inhibiting and activation are possible. Both plus and minus effects are possible. Embryos of certain creatures are being slowed down, etc. So these are different studies were mainly conducted in 1980s, 1990s. That's when magnetobiology and biophysics started its fast development. And finally, we've decided to make an experimental study at our center that would confirm that magnetic field is able to impact the growth plates. And for that, we took 34 young rabbits of a Soviet chinchilla kind. The object of study were the growth plates of knee joints. Parts. And the factor was magnetic field of 1.5 Tesla that was generated by a standard instrument, Omic 01. And we've did the impact of the knee joint of the rabbit 5 times a week for 3 weeks. For 10 minutes. Thus, it was a chronic exposure to the magnetic field. At a meeting of biophysicists, I've called this irradiation. I was stopped. It's not irradiation, it's magnetic field. We should say exponents into magnetic field. The animals were subdivided into two groups, control group and experimental group. The experimental group was subject to magnetic field for the assessment. We've used morphometry and autoradiography, and we did the statistical data processing. The light microscopy, we'll not go in for details, that's our illustration. That's what the growth plate of the rabbit knee joint looks like. This is the illustration of autoradiography. The picture is not the best, but the next slide will show you better. Well, the animal, before it is taken out of the experiment, is given some 3-HTMidine. This is a radioactive marker, and it has the troposity. It is fixed in the nuclei of splitting cells, and it's proportional to DNA synthesis. Thus, we had a chance to assess the level of DNA synthesis. For that, we've used animals of different age, and thus we received the base for comparison. Well, let me make a small deviation. When we've published this data of control group, which wasn't getting any treatment, that was in the year 98-99. Since then till now, last time, I've got the last letter yesterday. They keep inviting inviting me to conferences dedicated to the physiology of rabbits. The last conference was in Brazil, I believe. Well, this is the autoradiography. Encircled are the darker nuclei. There, the 3H thymidine is fixed, is located. The results. On the left-hand side, you can see the femur, and here we count the number of cells. Lilac color are controlled animals, red color are the experimental animals, and the other bone, the thymus, as you can see, there's more cells of gross plates. We've calculated all the cells of the cells with inclusions of 3H thymidine. It was called the index of marked nuclei. The control animals, you can see there are 2 units, and the other animals is 0.5. Same modifications of the other bone. Thus, definitely DNA synthesis was brought down. There was the slowdown of proliferation of chondrocytes of gross plates. These are very indicating slides. You can see before and after treatment. The right-hand side is the gross plate after the coronal of magnetic field impulse of 1.5 Tesla. There's the deformation of those coin columns, parts with no cells at all. The width of the gross plate is much smaller now. This is the beginning of the closing of the gross plate. Next, having obtained these results, we wanted to share our experience, to underline our new experience. And life made us meet one of the greatest magnetologists, Professor Valery Lednev. Unfortunately, he is not with us for many years. He died several years ago, but nevertheless, his works influenced the development of magnetobiology a lot. When Professor Lednev saw our results, he was a bit surprised. First, he said, why the clinic, which is actually dealing with such works, why our clinic, why our center? And second, why are we using such strong magnetic fields up to 1.5 Tesla? For us, it was the opening that the same result may be obtained using a much weaker physiological magnetic fields. And Valery Васильевич gave us like the second breath. He inspired us. Thanks to him, we met a great scientist, engineer, and physicist, Mr. Gennady Sokolov, a professor who is here in this hall. I'm happy to see you, Gennady. And with his assistance, we obtained some instruments that may generate the physiological weak magnetic fields that have no bad influence on the child. You will see magnetic impulse therapy, and you will understand what are the feelings of the child. They're not that pleasant. Next, the following works. We already did targeted work. We did the parametric resonance model of Lednev. He had it published yet in the year 1991. And his main input in the development of magnetobiology was that he determined the primary targets of magnetic fields for the human organism or for the live organism. Experiment number 2 used weaker fields, same scheme, but the experimental animals this time were mice. That was more convenient. And here is the most impressive result, radiography. The index of marked nuclei was changed, and it was changed. Lilac color is the control group, and the middle column is a magnetic field with a resonance frequency of calcium ions, and on the right there's the resonance frequency of potassium ions. And in comparison with the control group, see, the calcium field may seriously stimulate the proliferative processes in the growth plates, while potassium field is slowing down the process a little bit. It's not quite obvious, but there's a trend. So there's the femoral bone and the other bone. And in conclusion, let me tell you that due to the experimental works conducted in our clinic on the basis of Cytology Institute of the Academy of Sciences, with great theoretical support of the Institute of Experimental Biophysics of the Russian Academy of Sciences, and thanks to the support of such an enthusiast as Mr. Gennady Sokolov, we've obtained results that testify that magnetic field is able to influence the functional activity of growth plates, both in a negative and in a positive way. And I would like to finish the experimental part with this. I do not know about the questions. Maybe we shall do Q&A session after the clinical part. Ladies and gentlemen, I think that let the presenter continue in order for us to have a general view, a more full view of his work. Moreover, this area is being continued in our center, and maybe it would be interesting for you when you go to the center to see all the equipment. The work is of extreme interest and importance, but probably it's not for me to say great to my colleagues. Eva? Спасибо за такую прекрасную лекцию, но ваши результаты очень интересные. Надеюсь, что будет очень важно в лечении детей. Вчера я представил наш опыт с эпифизиодезом и преследующие те же цели. В некоторых случаях можно и у детей решать такие проблемы, но для этого, я думаю, нужно продолжать такие эксперименты и получить первые случаи, может быть, на других животных, не только экспериментальных. Можно быть, здесь нужно более внимательно смотреть на побочные явления магнитных полей, потому что при применении препаратов всегда проводят тесты на возможное онкогенетическое воздействие. Но думаю, что метод очень перспективный, и он может заменить, например, метод бурения, который мы используем для эпифизиодеза. Highly esteemed Professor Marzhek, the second part of the presentation of Alexei will be dedicated to the way we've done from experiment to clinical results. So now he will present the clinical results. You're welcome, Alexei. Great thanks for your additions. I would like only to add to the experimental part that I didn't include some slides into the presentation, but we have conducted another experiment on pregnant rats. We started a possible teratogenic impact of the magnetic fields with the parameters we are using. The exposition was for a full animal, and then we studied the embryos. We considered them in terms of macro anomalies, then the post-mortem analysis with no deviations found. I didn't consider it worthwhile to include them into this presentation. And now to my second part, the role and place of magnetotherapy in treating the orthopedic diseases in children. Role and place of magnetotherapy is very conditional, because in medicine, magnetotherapy has been used from the time of Hippocrates. But nevertheless, this graph shows the efficacy of different approaches. It may be etiological therapy, pathogenetic, or symptomatic. Three columns, hence. In full, this may be said about magnetotherapy as well. If we're using this method very targetedly, selectively, we can receive at least the an alternative of pathogenetic treatment. Let's take idiopathic scoliosis. One of the main tasks of the conservative comprehensive therapy is normalization of the intensity of the spine growth. Magnetic fields may impact the proliferative activity of the chondrocyte of growth plates. We have used this method in the clinical practice. As a result, when we statistically processed the data, we have selected two groups of children. The control group, 50 children, received comprehensive conservative treatment in an inpatient department without the use of magnetotherapy. And the main group, a little bit more than 100 children, received the same therapy, but with the inclusion of magnetotherapy. The work has been carried at the end of the 90s, and at that time in St. Petersburg, we have not used Chenon method yet, so the children were not wearing correcting braces. The control group, as a result, had an improvement without any dynamic of worsening. We use clinical science, X-ray, CT, electromyography, and podometry. Only if for each of these diagnostic methods we received positive dynamics, we assess this as improvement. Improvement meant stop of progressing and partial correction of the arch, 56%. In main group, the children who received magnetotherapy, we had 80% of improvement. Without no dynamics, 15% of children in control group, 14% in the main group. Further progression, 29% in the control group and 6% in the main group. Let me present some clinical examples. This is the dynamics of spondylograms of one patient starting from 11 and up to 14 years of age. You see that after the red arrow shows the courses of comprehensive therapy with magnetic therapy, no Chenon brace. The data from spondylogram of this patient have been used to build up the Kowalbu preclassical curve. When the patient look at the spondylograms, this was a girl, 11 to 14 years, she continues to grow. We had to receive the further increase of this red curve, the scoliotic deformation, but this doesn't happen. Another clinical example, similar processing with the dual Bopre curve. Another series of X-rays, 2009, 2010, 2012, and 2013. This child twice came to our clinic. We could not convince the parents and the child for the orthesis, but still we received such a result. No Chenon brace used. Though we think that as of today, this is not right. And now let me present you one of the brightest examples, the congenital pathology, the Wiedemann-Beckwith syndrome. This little boy, we first saw him when he was 7 months of age. He comes from Ufa city. With this, when children have this rare genetic pathology, Wiedemann-Beckwith syndrome, they have macrosomy. Usually these are quite large children. Hemagglobin hypertrophy, you see that the right lower part and the upper limbs, very big belly and a very big tongue that cannot fit inside the mouth. These are the most visual manifestations of this syndrome. And with growth, gamma hypertrophy has to increase. So these photos were taken at 7 months of age. The next photograph was made by his mother, so the quality of the photo is not very good. This is 14 months of age, so the interval between the two photos is around 5 to 6 months. The length of the body increased by 7 centimeters, and the size of the defect, the difference in the length of the lower extremities, was doubled. And these pictures show the same patient when he was hospitalized last time in our clinic. In 1.5 years, for the last 6-7 months, he grew by 8 centimeters, and the difference between the length of the lower extremities did not increase, or vice versa, some correction is visual. You can see this on the x-rays. The x-rays were carried in October 2012, 7 months of age. You see that there is a shortening of both the shank and the hip, but the hip is... we have the gamma hypertrophy on the right side. Next x-ray is March 2013. We see that the defect is still there, a little bit even more. The difference is in ossification of the heads of the femora. And the end of July 2013, the last x-ray, the length of the femoral bones is less by one centimeter. And the clinical picture, this is certainly not a very nice picture taken by his mother, but if we look at this child, we see the cosmetic clinical defect. The boy started walking. Certainly it's not the benefit of our magnetotherapy. It was just quite natural. Another clinical example, a very unique patient. We first saw this girl from when she was 8 months, and now she's almost seven. This is Kurzul's syndrome, a very rare congenital or inherited pathology, and which also envisages gamma hypertrophy. You see a normal right leg and a gigantic left one. There was a congenital defect of 1 centimeter difference between two legs. Her mother was an obstetrician, and they went to a very highly esteemed orthopedic institution for the consultation. What's to be done? No surgeon would operate a small an infant at 8 months of age, but her mother saw that the defect was increasing. We tried our procedures, no miracle, the defect did not go away. But in the course of more than 5 years, look at the girl, she is almost of school age. You see under her right foot, the Volkov-Zman book, which is 4 centimeters thick. And now almost at school age, we do not see any increase of the defect. It's the same book. There's a photograph of the face of this patient with the consent of her mother, because for this syndrome, the asymmetry of the face is also characteristic. We did not do anything with the face, but you see that the face is evening up with age. And finally, the last illustration, which I would like to present. At our conferences, all Russian and international conferences, very often surgeons, especially aggressive surgeons, ask us, why are you doing this? It is much easier to wait for the end of the bone growth and install Elizarov instrumentation, or maybe temporary arrest of the growth place, which is very trendy operation as of now. But some 5 years ago, we had this 16-year-old girl in our clinic with the initial diagnosis of the congenital shortening of the low right limb. The defect was around 5 to 6 centimeters. She came to us after operative treatment. In order to increase the shank's length by 5 centimeters, she had the Elizarov instrumentation for 8 months, but it doesn't always bring such good results. Then in the course of 1 year, she had to use a special bus leather instrumentation because the leg was very weak. So I always have a question to aggressive surgeons. If we manage to win 1 centimeter at least, and the girl would have to spend not 7 but 6 months in the Elizarov's apparatus. So this is the increase of the quality of life in any case. Thank you for your attention.